Harper Audio presents The Plot to Kill Hitler. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Pastor, Spy, Unlikely Hero, by Patricia McCormick. Performed by Adam Verner. He who passively accepts evil is as much involved in it as he who helps to perpetuate it. He who accepts evil without protesting against it is really cooperating with it. Martin Luther King, Jr. Prologue. April 5th, 1943. The Gestapo would arrive any minute. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, waiting peacefully in his book-lined study, had been expecting this day for a long time. He arranged his files carefully on his desk and opened his diary to a page with fake entries to throw Hitler's men off his trail. Then he removed a panel from the ceiling and hid a letter alongside a sheaf of papers he'd stashed there earlier. The purr of a diesel engine announced the arrival of a black Mercedes on the leafy Berlin street outside his house. Two of Hitler's secret police agents got out and climbed the stairs to the third-floor study. They told the blonde, boyish-looking Bonhoeffer to come with them. He calmly said goodbye to his parents, put his Bible under his arm, and left. Upstairs, under the rafters, was proof in his own handwriting that this quiet young minister was part of a conspiracy to kill Hitler. 1. A big, rambunctious family. 1906-14. Most of the homes in Breslau, Germany, had tidy front yards, neatly tended gardens, and thick Persian rugs in the parlor. But at the Bonhoeffer home, chickens strutted across the tennis court. Lizards, snakes, and rabbits were kept in a small zoo near the kitchen, and the family's pet nanny goat wandered freely in and out of the parlor. The children, 4 boys and 4 girls, went to school at home in a makeshift classroom with desks, chalkboards, and a trunk full of wigs, hats, and costumes. The family had a governess, a nursemaid, a cook, a housemaid, and a chauffeur, but their mother, Paula Bonhoeffer, was their teacher. She was strict when it came to table manners, but otherwise she loved to say yes to her children's ideas. So when her oldest sons, Carl Friedrich, 14, Walter, 13, and Klaus, 12, asked to dig up the front yard to create an underground passageway, she agreed. The boys tunneled all the way to the edge of the property, a stand of pine trees the children called the wilderness. Meanwhile, the girls, Ursula, 11, Crystal, 10, Sabina, 7, and Suzanne, 4, took over an upstairs room and turned it into a gigantic dollhouse. One time they played all day, until the nursemaid rang the dinner bell. They quickly washed and assembled around a massive dining room table. Everyone was present and accounted for, except 7-year-old Dietrich. The nursemaid went out on the veranda and called his name over and over again. Eventually, his twin sister, Sabina, spotted him lying on his back, lost in a daydream in his secret garden hideout. He came in sheepish and sunburned, completely oblivious to the fact that he'd held up dinner again. Dietrich was the dreamer in the family. His father, Carl, was one of the most prominent psychiatrists in Germany, and his mother came from an aristocratic family full of intellectuals. His older brothers were bigger, stronger, smarter, and as Dietrich saw it, better at everything. Carl Friedrich, the oldest, was a genius at physics. He would later help Albert Einstein split the atom. Walter could speak several languages, and he could identify every flower and tree he saw. Klaus, who their father said was perhaps the brightest of them all, was also the wit in the family. Dietrich's sisters were formidable, too. Ursula was a beauty, and like her father, she studied psychiatry. Crystal studied zoology. Sabina, Dietrich's twin, was athletic. And Suzanne, the baby, seemed to be good at everything. Dietrich sometimes felt lost in this big, rambunctious, and talented family. He tried to do everything his big brothers did, but because they were so much older, he was often dragged into playing dolls with his sisters. And so he would wander off to the garden to be alone. He would watch the clouds scud by overhead, feel the breeze rustle the pine needles in the forest nearby, and think. He would wonder, how did God create the world? Did God love everyone, even bad people? Did God eat lunch? But it was the sight of horses pulling a black-draped casket on its way to a nearby cemetery that set him off on a lifelong quest. From that day on, he became obsessed with a single question: what happens after we die? Many nights as he lay in bed across from Sabina, with only the glow of a small cup candle on the windowsill to light the darkened room, he would ask her if she could possibly imagine something as awe-inspiring as eternity. "It sounds long and gruesome," she said. "If you believed in heaven," he argued, "dying wouldn't be hard at all." But for all his big talk, Dietrich was often afraid in everyday life. He was too nervous to walk home from school alone. He was terrified of learning to swim. And when a family friend dressed up as Father Christmas and surprised the Bonhoeffer children, Dietrich froze in terror, hiding behind Sabina's skirt. Sometimes he would summon up the courage to cut through the wilderness to visit his beloved grandmother, Julie Toffel, who kept an antique silver box filled with chocolate, waiting for him when he visited. And sometimes, while the others were outside chasing butterflies, he would plink away at the piano keys. Soon, he was playing Mozart sonatas. By 12, he was composing his own songs. The whole family was musical. They gathered together many nights after dinner to sing hymns and folk songs. But Dietrich, it seemed, was a prodigy. Finally, it appeared he had found his talent. His parents arranged for him to take lessons from a demanding teacher, and they began to think he would become a professional musician. But his heart was never fully in his music, and so for much of his childhood, he remained the tag-along little brother. But someday, Dietrich, the little boy who was afraid of Father Christmas, would become best known for standing up to Hitler. 2. War breaks out. 1914. Dietrich and Sabina were at a carnival on a hot August day in 1914, when their governess suddenly dragged them away from the horse-drawn merry-go-round. All around them, the stalls and rides were being hastily shut down. World War I had broken out in Europe. Like a lot of 8-year-old boys, Dietrich was fascinated with the war. When he was younger, he'd asked for pop guns and toy soldiers for Christmas. Now he pored over newspaper accounts of reports from the front. He tacked a map on a wall in the family's new home in Berlin and kept track of every move of the German army with colored pins. War was exciting, even romantic, for a boy who followed Germany's victories with pride. With his brothers away at school, now it was Dietrich's turn to drag his little sisters into games where they spied on enemy troops and stormed the ramparts, acting out the latest triumph of the German troops. World War I started with the assassination of the Archduke of Austria in Sarajevo. The Austro-Hungarians invaded Serbia, and Russia entered the fight on the side of the Serbians. Germany used the conflict to attack neutral Belgium and Luxembourg, then invaded France. The British came in on the side of the French, and a world war had begun. It would last for more than 4 years and result in almost 9 million combatant deaths and more than 7 million civilian deaths, mainly because of a protracted stalemate in France. It would mark the first time barbed wire and poison gas were used. When there were food shortages, Dietrich became the family scout, scouring the streets to find out which shops still had plums and exploring the nearby fields for mushrooms. He spent his allowance on a hen so the family could have fresh eggs, and when the family went on holiday, the nanny goat was loaded in the train's luggage car so the Bonhoeffers could have milk every day. But his boyish romance with war ended abruptly when his oldest brother, Carl Friedrich, was called up for service. Now, suddenly, the war was all too real. The Bonhoeffer family was well-to-do and influential. They could have easily used their connections to keep their son out of the fighting. But Carl Friedrich saw it as his patriotic duty to serve. Indeed, he enlisted in the infantry, where the need and the danger was greatest. He left home as soon as he turned 18, taking his physics textbook with him. When Walter left a few months later, he brought just one possession from home, his Bible. Dietrich stood by helplessly as his mother ran alongside the departing train and then stood weeping as it disappeared down the tracks. Day by day, he followed his brother's progress on his map, trying to reassure his mother with news of Germany's victories. One bright May morning, Dietrich, Sabina, and Suzanne were playing outside when a delivery boy arrived with a telegram. Walter was dead. He had been hit by a bomb fragment and died of infection. Dietrich could scarcely understand. How could God have let this happen? He and Sabina watched as their big, sturdy father bent over, his head in his hands. The children stood nearby, too frightened to comfort him. Finally, Dr. Bonhoeffer rose, and clutching the railing with shaking hands, he went upstairs to tell his wife. Paula Bonhoeffer was so devastated, she lay in a darkened room upstairs for nearly 6 weeks. After Walter's death, letters he'd written from his sickbed arrived, asking his parents to come visit him. The last one, written just hours before his death, said he was not thinking about the pain, but instead longing for his family, minute by minute throughout the long days and nights. The lively Bonhoeffer home became hushed and gloomy. Carl Bonhoeffer shut himself away in his study. Paula Bonhoeffer hid upstairs, reading Walter's last letter again and again. Dietrich tried to cheer up his parents with his piano playing, but it was no use. He and his sisters tiptoed around the darkened house. The eerie stillness of their home was broken when another telegram delivery boy rang the bell. Carl Friedrich had been injured. A few days later, there was more bad news. Now Klaus was to report for duty. His father was distraught, his mother inconsolable. They had lost one son, another was still on the front line, and a third was about to be drafted. When Klaus left to join the army, Dietrich would be the only son left at home. How could he show his parents that he was grown up enough to help shoulder their grief, that he could take care of them? On the day of Walter's funeral, Dietrich stepped up to the altar. He looked out at his heartbroken parents. Then he took a breath and sang in a clear, unwavering voice one of Walter's favorite hymns. His parents were touched by their youngest son's valiant effort to comfort them. But the Bonhoeffer family, which had seemed to lead such a charmed life, was shattered. Their father couldn't bear to be in the room if Walter's name was mentioned. Their mother fell into a severe depression. Dietrich was stunned. Now the death had come to his family. All his idealistic notions about eternity were thrown into doubt. 3. Bonhoeffer seals his destiny. 1918-27. When the war ended in 1918, Germany had been crushed. The shelves in Berlin shops were bare, and the proud German people were humiliated by the terms of surrender. Carl Friedrich and Klaus finally returned home, exhausted and disillusioned. Dietrich was still feeling lost in a family where his older brothers were the ones who were expected to do big things. He wasn't the war hero Walter had been. He wasn't a genius at physics like Carl Friedrich, who was now back at Berlin University, where he was a star student, and he didn't have the brilliant analytical mind that Klaus had begun to demonstrate at law school. Treaty of Versailles. The terms of this treaty to end World War I had a devastating effect on the German economy and psyche. Germany was required to give up land they'd seized in Poland, France, Belgium, Denmark, Africa, and Asia. The treaty also required Germany to pay the victors for war damages they had suffered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.